This episode is brought to you by Fundwise Capital. Fundwise Capital is a business lender matching platform. Avoid the mystery of one-sided deals. Connect with Fundwise to get the very best funding you can qualify for fast. You can apply online in 60 seconds or less, and there's no effect to your credit to see how much you can get. It's easy. Use the funding for anything you need to start or grow your business. You did hear me correctly. I did say start or grow your business. If you don't have a business yet, but you got a solid business plan, they can help you get funding. Get the best funding you can qualify for. Their strategic lender matching platform searches through hundreds of lenders to find the very best possible option for your unique situation. They have hundreds of five-star reviews on Google, Trustpilot, and Facebook, and an A-plus rating with the Better Business Bureau. They provide unsecured lines of credit at 0% interest for 9 to 15 months, unsecured term loans, loans based on income, short-term gap funding, and bridge loans. They work with real estate, startups like I already mentioned, franchises, restaurants, any kind of business, any kind of project. To get started, it's really easy. Just go to apply.fundwise.com/minddog. That's apply.fundwise.com/minddog. Get money for your business now. apply.fundwise.com/minddog. And brought to you by audiobooksnow.com. Audiobooks Now is different. What sets them apart? Simple. Price point, price point, price point. Audiobooks Now Club Pricing Plan is simply the best deal on audiobooks you'll find. It offers the savings and flexibility not found anywhere else. With their save on everything discounts, rollovers, exclusive offers, loyalty program, incredible selection, and cancel anytime policy, it simply cannot be beat. Plus, get a free premium audiobook on select titles when you click the link that's in the description. Start your 30-day free trial of the Club Pricing Plan, normally $4.99 a month, absolutely free to try for 30 days. You're not satisfied at any time, you just canceled, you won't be billed a penny. With Audiobooks Now Club Pricing Plan, you save on every audiobook you purchase. They do not use gimmicky credits to hide the true cost. Whether you want to save big through the Club Pricing Plan or simply purchase at their everyday low prices, they offer one of the largest selections of audiobooks anywhere. You can download or stream the audiobooks through the website or free apps, and all the apps include in-app purchasing. Check them out now, audiobooksnow.com. Use the promo code MINDDOG. And welcome, my friends, to yet another episode of the Mind Dog TV podcast. I'm Matt Napo. Thanks for coming. It's great to have you here, as always. Having a little technical issues there with the pre-show ads. It's a wonderful day to be alive here in New York. I hope it's a beautiful day wherever you are. Actually, it's not a beautiful day weather-wise. We're having some terrible thunderstorms right now, and I hope we don't lose power, which has been... an unfortunate, too often type of occurrence here with the thunderstorms we've been having this summer and into fall. But things are calm at the moment, so I'm hoping we're going to get this show in without any interruptions. What are we going to talk about today? Sword fighting. Yes, sword fighting. And you might think, and medieval sword fighting. At that, you might think, well, that's an unusual topic as first for, no, it's not a first, not a second, third time, I'm a little off today, third time we've had somebody who is an expert in medieval sword fighting on. I guess it's more popular than I could have imagined. I'm surprised that I've had one expert on the show in this subject. Was really surprised when the second one came along about a year later, and now just about a year after that we have a third one. So it's going to be an interesting conversation, and I'm really interested in the fact that the world has three people like my guest today. Dr. Guy Windsor is a world-renowned instructor and a pioneering researcher of medieval and Renaissance martial arts. He has been teaching the art of arms full-time since funding the School of European Swordsmanship in Helsinki, Finland in 2001. His day job is finding and analyzing historical swordsmanship treaties, figuring out the systems they represent, creating a syllabus from the treaties for his students to train with, and teaching the system to his students all over the world. In 2018, Edinburgh University awarded him a PhD in research publications for his work regarding historical combat systems. Ladies and gentlemen, please open your ears, open your minds, and help me welcome in Dr. Guy Windsor to the MindDog TV podcast. Welcome.
Hi, Matt. Nice to see you.
It's my pleasure, and thank you for coming. Now, it looks like you're in a war room right there. What do we got? What do we got?
This is just my study. So there's books and there's swords, which pretty much sums up most of my life.
Well, as you may have heard in the intro there, I'm astonished to find out that this stuff is as popular as it is. As I mentioned, you're not the first or even the second expert in medieval swordsmanship that I've had on the program. The first two were consultants to the entertainment industry. What drives your students to be interested in this topic?
Well, basically, some people, the first time they see a sword, or ideally they pick it up, they just light up inside. And for them, what they really want to do is pick up a sword and swing it, right? And it's an irreducible thing. It's like some people feel the same way when they see a particular classic sports car. They want to get in and drive it. Other people are mad about football and other activities. Some of us, swords just sing for us. And so people like that find me and my work. And my job is to basically help them to get good at swinging that sword around in a historically authentic manner.
Right. And so do you consult at all for entertainment purposes, filmmaking or theatrical shows or Renaissance fairs or any of that kind of stuff? Or is this purely a college, I'm struggling for the words here.
It's a martial art. It's like academic exercise.
It's not, okay.
Combat sports, mixed martial arts, have an arena where you go and there's a particular kind of contest and everyone knows who wins. Okay. Right. And you've got stage combat, like theatrical combat or on the screen, where the idea is everybody sees what's going on, but nobody actually gets hurt.
Right.
And there's a lot of crossover in those two areas, lots of similar physical skills, kicking, punching, throwing, swinging weapons around, that sort of thing. And what we do is related to both, but it's different in that what we're trying to do is fence each other in the way that it was done when it was done for real. So for example, one of these swords here will come from a particular period. Let's take this rapier, for example, this one with the fancy hilt. There are books from the early 1600s, which tell you how they were using those swords in the early 1600s, which is the period that that sword is from. It's a copy, obviously, it's not the real thing. And so we figure out from those books how they used to fence back in the day, and then we try and recreate that. Sometimes it's competitive, sometimes it's more like kata or forms, but people come and do it because they want to actually do it, not watch it or think about it. Now, the academic side of things is just the research that we have to do to figure out how it used to be done. But that's just part one. We also have to figure out how to train it without killing anyone. That's part two. And then we actually have to get on and actually train the skills. So I do all of those things, and I help my students learn to do whichever of those things they're most interested in.
Okay. Before we get it, because I'm very interested in how you go about researching this stuff, and I want to start there. But just because you mentioned that in show business stuff, nobody gets hurt. Does anybody get hurt in your classes?
No, it is extremely safe. Okay. Obviously, accidents do happen, but in the 20 years that my school in Helsinki has been going, we have had an ambulance called to the school once because a student had an epileptic fit for the first time in her life.
Wow. Okay.
That is the only time an ambulance has showed up at my school.
Very cool. Okay. Good to know nobody got stabbed.
We get bruises and bumps and things. And the thing is that the more dangerous the weapon is, the more precautions you take. So, for example, when we're doing like high-speed sparring, we're wearing all sorts of protective gear, like armored gauntlets and things like that.
Wow.
And the swords have rubber blunts on the end, so they're not intended to actually penetrate anything. But then sometimes for research purposes and for training purposes, we need to use sharp weapons. And then we dial it back a lot and we're super careful, and only the experienced students are ever using sharp weapons. And so it's a lot safer than you'd think, because it's obviously dangerous.
Right. You just showed me that thing. Now that's armor. It's got to weigh a ton, no?
A full suit of armor of this sort of style,
right,
which are so articulated plates, so they're kind of classic sort of knight in shining armor, will weigh about, depends on the armor, depends on exactly how it's set up, but somewhere, should we say, between 35 and 55 pounds, which is comparable to what a modern infantryman carries into combat.
Wow.
Right, and it's spread all over your body. So it's actually, the easiest way to carry armor is to wear it. And it's tiring, because you're carrying maybe, should we say, 45 pounds of metal on you. And it gets really hot because it doesn't ventilate at all, because, it's steel. And it's not perforated steel. You don't want to put holes in it. So it gets really hot. So temperature regulation is an issue. Fatigue is an issue. But you can roll around in it and climb up a stepladder and jump onto a horse, and it's for fighting it. So you can really move in that stuff.
Surprising. That is really surprising, because you would think it would be really hard to be really flexible and that kind of stuff wearing it. Because it's essentially a metal, right?
Yeah, but it's interlocking plates that slide over each other and they're jointed. And so it is very carefully made. Okay, good armor is tailor-made to the individual person who's wearing it. And there's a whole sort of system for putting it on. So most of the weight is on your waist, just like a rucksack. So the waist of the armor is usually pretty tight, and it kind of cinches on, and then that carries the weight of the leg plates, and it kind of supports the sort of upper chest pieces. And then you've got armor on your arms where, that weighs, but it's not that much, even when you've got like big extra elbow plates on.
Right. Very surprising stuff. Now, let's start with the researching stuff.
Okay,
because
sure.
I'm thinking now, nobody in medieval times was thinking, well, I should write this down, because sometime in the 21st century, somebody's going to want to know about this stuff. So the challenges of finding out about this stuff, there's not like a written course in it from, hundreds and hundreds of years ago, is there? Maybe I'm wrong. Looks like I'm wrong.
Okay. This is just one manuscript. Obviously, this is a facsimile, so it's a modern reproduction of a manuscript. I'll try and hold it so the light doesn't shine too much. And this one, let me get it to work with the camera. There we go.
Oh, yeah.
So this one was handwritten, hand-drawn in around 1400. And the original manuscript is in the Getty Museum in Los Angeles. And it has in it wrestling, defenses against the dagger, how to murder somebody with a dagger, the blows of the sword, guards of the sword, the various techniques for the sword, then sword in armor, then poleaxe in armor, spear on horseback, sword on horseback, and even wrestling on horseback.
Wow. Right?
So, and this was written in about 1400 for a chap called Niccolo d'Este, who was the Marquis of Ferrara, so a senior and a very important military figure. And it was written by a guy called Fiore de Liberi, who we don't know a great deal about him, but we do know that the main street in his hometown of Premariaco is still named after him today.
Wow.
So he was highly respected. And yeah, his manuscript survives, and there are four different copies of it that have survived from the early 1400s.
And how were they located? I mean, they were in museums or somewhere, but when they first archaeological digs or something, where did they find these books?
They're kept in libraries. I mean, a manuscript like that has been kept in somebody's library for hundreds of years and passed, you know, as books were really expensive back in the 15th century because they were all handmade. And so it tended to be only rich people, and they didn't have that many of them. And they were looked after really pretty well. And as the library got sort of moved or stolen or whatever, the books tended to be kept because they were expensive and valuable. And I mean, for example, the Duke of Urbino in the 1680s had a copy of a different manuscript in the same sort of style, same sort of medieval combat material. And that book we know was there in, I'm going to get my dates wrong because it's live TV. I'm going to say 1482. And we know it was gone by, I think, 1500 or something. But anyway, what happened was Cesare Borgia took the town of Urbino from the Duke. And one of the things he did was he took all the stuff in the library and just stole it for his own library. Right. So people cared about these books. Right. And in the 19th century, it was owned by a collector who collected hundreds and hundreds of these sorts of manuscripts and on lots of different subjects. And eventually it got bought by the Getty Museum in, I think, the 1960s. And it's been there ever since.
Wow. You know what? I think it's probably a cultural thing that on this side of the world, there were no people here writing stuff down in, you know, in the 1400s and 1300s and stuff like that. So from a Western Hemisphere type of perspective, it's surprising to, and not spending a whole lot of time in Europe, surprising to find that these books were maintained and all that kind of stuff, because we have nothing like that here.
Well, okay. An Italian-American friend of mine said, no, we do have medieval buildings built by my ancestors, but they're in Italy.
Wow.
So I mean, yeah, this is part of, you know, every human being's cultural heritage, but particularly this is Italian, and you know, and it's actually in America right now. It's in the Getty Museum, and there's even in New York, where you are, in the Morgan Library, there is a different copy of the same text, and yeah, they might show it to you if you ask really nicely, but it's right there in New York.
Right.
I'm very jealous.
Some of the challenges with, you know, Asian martial arts, learning it from a book, it's very difficult. Can you reproduce that faithfully, learning it from a book, or have there been masters throughout the years who have actually physically been teaching this stuff forever?
No, because what happened was this was current military technology, okay? And if you ask a modern soldier how to shoot a 17th century gun, they probably won't have the first idea, because that's not what they're trained to do. Because as the technology changes and the way of fighting changes, so what is taught to actual warriors changes. So with a living tradition, you have the issue of every generation of teachers changes things slightly. Okay. So if you have a living tradition spanning 500 years, it's almost impossible that what you're being taught 500 years later is the same as what was taught 500 years ago. It's almost impossible.
Absolutely. Yeah.
What a book does is it takes a snapshot of what this one particular master was thinking at that time. And then that snapshot doesn't change over the next 500 years. Okay. So we can look at that book and go, right, in this case, 600 years ago, this is what this particular person wanted to say about the art of arms. And yeah, we will never know how accurately we've got it. But I mean, that's true for any question, right? Ask any scientist, right? In any field of science where they're actually doing research, they know that they are never going to get it completely right. They might get the next bit of the picture, but they're never going to get it completely right. And the same in history.
Right.
We have a pretty good idea of the Battle of Waterloo and what happened, but we're never going to get every detail of it right. Well, that doesn't mean we shouldn't research.
Most John Q. Public people like me, when we hear historians or scientists talking about stuff, we assume that they do have it absolutely right. Like, and the question is always, how? How could they possibly know this stuff? And I'm glad to hear you actually say that, you know, we don't know if it's ever 100% right. We can just right. make a best guess, I guess, assumption based on the literature that remains and all that stuff.
And the critical thing, though, is that you show you're working. So Fiore says on this page, you know, stand like this, step like this. When your opponent does this, do that. And then he shows you a picture of what happens when the blades meet and what happens immediately afterwards. And it's really clear who's doing what because he has a system for like showing you on the page who is doing what.
Right.
Okay. So that, yeah, we can never be certain that we're doing it exactly right. But in this particular example, there is a lot of information to go on, and you can have several different interpretations that match the text and match the pictures. But then with lots and lots of practical experiment, you will probably think, well, actually, this one seems to work better at speed with sharp swords. So this is what we're going to say is how we think this is done right now.
Wow. What is the origin? I mean, because when I think of sword fighting and I think of swordsmanship in general, my mind goes back to Asia and samurais. Is there any connection from that or any relationship between like ancient samurai swordsmanship and what you do?
There wasn't a great deal of contact between Europe and Japan up until the 19th century. Okay, so there is no reason to suppose that the samurai were borrowing much from us, and there's no reason to suppose we were borrowing much from the samurai. But there are stories of, for example, Portuguese traders in Japan having fights with samurai. And so whenever you have two cultures having sword fights, they will learn sword fighting stuff off each other. But there's no evidence of Japanese style techniques in Europe. And the thing is, like, Europeans at the time are just as like clever and motivated as we are now. They just had a different educational space and a different set of beliefs and a different culture that they're working in. But these people were bright, and the people who are really good at fighting and really good at expressing the art, they are every bit the intellectual equal of you or I.
Right. So where did this actually begin? I mean, can you trace it back to its origins? Does it go back to, you know, before, you know, the year 1000, 900?
Okay. We know that people were practicing swordsmanship in ancient Greece, because we have stories of people like Achilles, right, doing amazing things with swords.
Right.
Okay. So swords have been fundamentally important to European culture generally since records began, okay, and since stories began, okay. So the sword has been around. Pretty much every culture that has the technology to produce one has produced some kind of a sword,
right?
Okay, so the earliest book that has been written to actually display a complete system of swordsmanship is this one, which is, I'll get you a picture of the book itself. This is obviously not the real thing. The real thing is in the Royal Armouries in Leeds, right, in the UK. And so this is a modern edition, which has English and transcription on one side and the pictures from the manuscript on the other. But this book was written, we want to say around 1320. It's not dated, but it's, we can date it from internal and external evidence to around 1320, 1340. So that's pretty old. But swords massively predate the idea of writing how sword fighting works down in a book. And this is the earliest one that we know of. It's called Royal Army's Manuscript 133.
I'm still on the origin stuff. This is fascinating to me, because at some point, some human being had to sit down with a piece of metal and say, or not say, but have the thought, like, I'm going to heat this up, I'm gonna beat it down, sharpen it. The idea of where that came from is fascinating to me. Are you not as fascinated as I am about how that came about?
But swords predate metal, right? So even before people were making swords out of iron or bronze, they were making sword-like objects out of wood and stone. If you look in, for example, Aboriginal culture in Australia, right? In the museums in Australia, they have giant swords made of wood, and they are, without any shadow of a doubt, swords. I mean, they are weapons held in the hand, and you use them for killing people with a sharpish edge. It's made of wood, but still, it will take some. It might not take the head completely off, but it will certainly split it in half. Or it's like long and pointy, and you can stick it in a person. I mean, people have been making swords out of whatever was to hand long before they figured out how to make them out of metal. And the earliest metal swords were almost certainly bronze. And then they were made out of iron, and then they were made out of steel. And when steel became more sort of from Roman times onwards,
right?
Steel has been the material of choice because it simply performs better than anything else that we've ever discovered.
So that's kind of like a performance-enhancing drug, steel.
Really?
So does that affect the art, right? As the materials that the swords are being made from gets better, it changes the art form in some way, does it not?
Yes, absolutely. So for one obvious thing is that bronze swords are all fairly short, because once they get past a certain length, the bronze isn't strong enough to maintain that structure, and it will become basically too wobbly. Okay. Whereas steel swords, I mean, the longest ones are outstandingly long. I mean, longest ones that are actually used to actually fight people can be 6 feet long.
Wow.
They're fairly rare, but yeah. I mean, I have a sword, not sadly in this room, it's in my cell in Finland, which is 5 feet long, and you can pick it up and swing it around in one hand, and it behaves beautifully, but it's steel. And you can get that kind of performance out of steel.
Yeah, I get it. So it's part of the master's journey. Somebody who gets interested in this, is part of that making your own sword, or do people rely on like metallurgy people to make the swords for them? Because if I got into this, I'd want to make my own sword. I'd want to be part of that right from the beginning. Is that part of the mindset?
Okay. Generally speaking, some smiths do fence, and some fencers can do some smithing. I've made so far two knives, and I thoroughly enjoyed it. And it was enough experience to know that making a sword is fantastically high level smithing. Wow. Because the skills you need to make a blade this big that performs really well is quite different to making a blade this big or even bigger. So, yeah, it would be great if everyone could just make their own sword, but you know, you're looking at years and years of practicing the craft before you can make a sword that's worth having, I would think. So it's something to aspire to, and I am definitely going back to, there's a smith near where I live who does these day courses. I'm going to go back and make another knife, and then maybe at some point I might end up making a small sword, and then, or a shortish sword, and then maybe 10 years from now make a bigger one. I'd love to. But it is, It's like, okay, most drivers can't build a car from scratch.
Right.
It's the same sort of relationship.
What about the idea of because as you know, it seems like something, at least people like me aren't interested until we start learning about it. Now this whole conversation so far has already piqued my interest in it, that I'd love to see, you know, a film or documentary of how this is actually done and that kind of stuff. Do you have any interest in kind of doing that kind of work to bring this to a greater public awareness?
I have like 400 videos on my Vimeo channel.
Oh, okay.
So yeah, and actually, you know, with the pandemic, the various branches of my school where I go and teach are all shut, or they were shut. And so for the last couple of years, I've been basically teaching from home over Zoom, which is not great, but I've been producing online courses for the last 5 years. So a lot of it can be taught through books, which I write, and online courses, which I produce, and, you know, videos, which kind of get spread out over the internet. And there are actually lots and lots of people like me doing this. I'm not some lone outlier. There are There are hundreds of clubs, and there are probably, these days, there must be at least 20 people doing it for a living. Back when I started, I think there was one other person trying to make a living teaching swordsmanship. but since then, the field has grown, and the community has grown up around it. And so now, you know, we do have lots and lots of clubs, lots and lots of people doing research into lots of different fields. I mean, I do about 6 or 7 different historical styles, but there are at least another 10 that I've never touched, whereas other people have taken one or other of those 10 and become really good at it. So, I mean, there's a massive amount of choice out there.
You can find specialization people become really good at just one aspect of it?
Some people are drawn to a specific period, and so they'll tend to do the styles in that period. Others are drawn to a particular weapon, so they'll do like various styles of that weapon. And some other people are drawn just to the one particular source or book, and they will focus on that to the exclusion of everything else. I mean, I have colleagues who just do Fiore's Art of Arms. I have other colleagues who just do the sword and buckler from the 133 manuscript I showed you before. Others who just do, for example, Fabris style rapier. Lots of us do lots of them, but there are specialists, absolutely.
Very, very interesting stuff. Do you know what the interest level in the United States is? I mean, being there, I'm sure you probably don't follow all, like, everything that goes on in America, but here there's lots of Renaissance fairs. I'm not sure what the level of interest in actual swordsmanship by people taking it up to do themselves. Do you know if there's a big movement?
Okay.
Here?
Well, in non-pandemic times, I'm normally in America about 3 times a year teaching seminars.
Okay.
So there's that much interest. And about, from my book sales and online course sales, about 80% of my income comes from America. So
wow.
America is like you'd think it would be Europe, but actually America is home to some of the absolute best researchers, best practitioners, best teachers, best clubs. I mean, it's particularly in the English speaking world, there's vastly more stuff going on in the States than pretty much anywhere else.
I think they hide.
No, well, they don't.
I mean, they're definitely not part of the popular culture consciousness. Like it's you don't see a lot of it on media. You don't see any. So that's why I'm surprised by it. I mean,
yeah. But if you look, if you go into a browser and you do a search for historical martial arts or historical swordsmanship, there are lots of different terms that are used. You'll find, I mean, I know at least, I personally know 2 clubs in New York.
Wow.
Right? That's just New York. And there's probably 2 or 3 others that I don't know.
I know of one in New York, too. I think back 50 years, I had a friend in high school who was completely into swords. And he had a wall of swords, different kinds of swords. And basically that. The culture that came up with this whole swordsmanship stuff in Europe, though, I'm wondering if it was something that, you know, somebody would be training for from a very early age to be part of like an army or stuff, and at what age they would start to recruit people and say, you're going to be a great warrior, we would start training in swordsmanship at like 5 or 6 or whatever. Do you do a lot of research into the culture of different areas within Europe that kind of had a swordsmanship culture within their bigger culture?
I have colleagues who do more research into that area than I do. But basically, you were born into it. So if you're born into the knightly classes and you happen to be a boy, you will be expected to learn the art of arms as it was in your period. So if we take, say, 1400, in Italy, for instance, and let's say you were born to a knight who, you know, lives in a small castle or a fortified house somewhere, you would probably, at the age of around 10, maybe a little younger, maybe a little older, be sent to a colleague or a friend or an overlord to train or be trained to become a knight in their castle. Okay, because the theory was that, you know, if your mother's hanging around, she might intervene in the kind of nastiness of some of the training. So they were basically sent away to be trained. And then at the age of about 18, 19, 20, they would be knighted, which was, at that time, it was basically similar to getting a commission in the army. So the army was mostly made up of professional warriors of the warrior class and effectively conscripts. And the people who got the real training were the knights, and how well they trained their conscripts really depended on all sorts of factors, which gets really, really complicated. But then by the 1500s, you had basically a lot more trade going on. And so you had people who were getting rich through trade, who were then sort of taking on the sort of customs and habits and pastimes of their social superiors. And so they were taking up fencing as a hobby, if you like. But all this time, anyone who lived in a city, any man particularly who lived in a city, would be expected to defend that city or fight for that city should the need arise. So you have professional warriors like Fiore, who at one point commanded the artillery on the walls of the city of Udine in northern Italy. And you have like the people who just live in the city who have to do a certain amount of military service. And oh, those people in that city over there are coming over with their army to give us a hard time. So, right, okay, we must, if we go together, out we go, bash, bash, bash. Hopefully we win. And there was an awful lot of it going on. And it was very much a sword-based culture. But it's worth remembering that in military terms, the sword was not the primary weapon. In military terms, normally, a spear or projectile weapons like archery and later on guns, they were the primary weapon. The sword was your backup weapon. So if you're a knight on a horse, you have a lance, and when your lance breaks or you drop it or you lose it somehow, you then pull out your sword to keep going. But it's the sword occupies a similar sort of place in martial culture back in, shall we say, 1400, as the pistol does in the modern army.
Wow.
It's a backup gun.
Ah, gotcha. I never thought of it that way, like the spear, because I'm thinking pre-guns, but the spear would be the primary weapon. I never thought of that. I mean, I just assumed it would be a sword, and everything was more, for lack of a better way to describe it, hand-to-hand or intimate battle rather than throwing something from a distance.
The spear is often, I mean, there are spears to be thrown, like javelins or the Roman pilum, but most often the spears were actually held in the hand when they were fought with. And some of them are like really, really long, like 4 or 5 yards long. And the thing is, I learned this the hard way many years ago doing a reenactment in the UK. I had a sword, and this guy came at me on the field, and he had a spear, and he hit me like 18 times before I could get close enough to hit him, because the spear is a really good weapon. But also, I hadn't trained in how to use a sword against a spear. Fiore does actually tell you how to do that in his manuscript.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
So it's a useful skill to have. The spear is a lot cheaper to produce. And if you have to equip, say, 500 men with a weapon, you want to have a small, expensive spearhead on a long, cheap stick. You don't want to have a very, very expensive sword.
Gotcha. Yeah, makes sense. Now, you mentioned a couple of times there, and without really kind of bringing it to the forefront, that if you had a son, and then you said a man would be.
Yes. So,
but now I know that at least one of the people who I interviewed prior to you, who was into swords, was a woman. So now I know that women do it, but at that time it was primarily a male thing.
Primarily, but I have to show you this because this is way cool. The very last pages of the surviving pages of this manuscript, there is the priest who wrote the book giving a woman called Walpurgis a fencing lesson. So already in the 1300s, we have some kind of documentary evidence that women were at least having a go at sword and buckler every now and then. And there are fantastic stories of women who did amazing feats of arms. And it's okay. I have a podcast myself, and I have a point of principle that half of my guests, or slightly over half of my guests, are women. Because there is this idea that, historically, most of the people using swords were men. This is true. But the whole point of a sword is it makes it much, much easier to win fights. You don't have to be bigger and stronger. You just have to be clever and faster. Okay. So there's absolutely no reason why women can't be fantastically good at swordsmanship. And in fact, I have had my ass handed to me by women on several occasions. So I can testify that women can be really, really good at historical swordsmanship.
Yeah. Well, no,
there's even like the man in the name, isn't it? Swordsmanship, which is annoying. But
I don't doubt that they could be very good at it. I just when the interest actually started happening, because I think you're right about, from what I can tell, and I haven't had a whole lot of experience in this, but it seemed to be women are far more passionate about the stuff than the men I've talked to about it, and you know, they just seem to be really I don't know whether it's the idea of competing with something that is thought to be traditionally a male thing, or just the idea of the romanticism of Renaissance stuff and medieval stuff that attracts people to it. But ladies definitely seem to be.
I think everyone who does it because they love it. So I haven't noticed any particular distinction between the women seem to be more enthusiastic about it than the men. It's like everyone who is a sword person who resonates when they pick up a sword, get into it and they just love it. And I've not noticed any particular distinction between, you know, I mean, I know of clubs in particularly in the States and in Canada that have more female students than male,
right,
which is unusual, but they are there.
Right. What about the different kinds of swords and the purpose of them? Because you think, you know, for, and I hate, you know, I am the dumb guy. I'm not acting here. You think a sword is a sword. Killing, you know, if it's efficient at killing, why so many different types of swords, and what are the different applications for?
Okay. Think of it like cars, right? Why are there so many different kinds of cars? Well, because there are different needs. Some people need to go really, really fast around corners. Other people need to carry lots of material. Other people want it to look good but don't have much money. Other people want it to look good and go really fast around corners and have loads of money. And so you have all this massive variation. So a knightly sword, where the assumption is that you are wearing armor or you have some kind of a shield, will tend to have an unprotected hand. So you just have a simple cross guard and nothing else. Okay, like this one. Yep.
Right.
But as people started to, in the 16th century, they started adding, or late 15th century, they started adding various things to the hilts to protect the hands, because they would be tending to use them, say, not on a battlefield or on a dueling ground. They would be having fights in the street around the back of the pub after an argument with somebody, right? And so you have, basically, there's changes in the use case, which make changes in the weapon, but then there's also changes in simply fashion. Certain kinds of swords became unfashionable, even though they worked really well.
Wow.
So the most famous example of this is sometime in the middle of the 17th century, no one's quite sure exactly where, swords went from being really long, this sort of length, which is a 42-inch blade from the cross guard to the point, and they can be a lot longer than that. The longest one I've handled had a 50-inch blade from cross guard to point. It's just gigantic. To something like this, this is actually a historical original from about, I think it's about 1720, which is much, much shorter, and it has a different cross section altogether, so you can't really cut with it, but it's really, really good at stabbing people.
Right.
And the thing is, there's no question, we've experimented with this extensively, that everything else being equal, this is not as good in a sword fight as the rapier, the longer, bigger one. And so the person with the rapier is likely to win. So the reason they were switching was not because it was a better technology. They were switching because it was fashionable to carry something like this. And the prevailing theory, and it's just a theory with very, very little evidence to back it up, was that the King of France, who was like the most powerful person in Europe at the time, was fed up with his courtiers tripping over each other with these great big long rapiers. And so he had a small sword made, and he started carrying it. As soon as the king had one, everyone wanted one. And so they all switched to these weapons quite quickly in quite a short period of time. And just because that's what's now fashionable. And it's the thing is,
a modern day good sword.
Yeah, I mean, it's yeah, exactly. It's a good sword, but it's not as good at killing people from further away as the bigger one,
right?
In the same way that, you know, someone with a, you know, a Bowie knife is a great knife, but against someone with a sword, the Bowie knife is generally at a disadvantage.
Right. So the effectiveness or efficiency of killing someone, better for a stab type of motion or like a I'm going to take your head off type of, you know, cut off.
Okay. This is literally the oldest argument in all of martial arts, which is better, cut or thrust. And it even persists today in bullet design, which is better, like a thin piercing round or a big smashing round. Okay.
What's your opinion? And,
well, my opinion is it really depends on what you want to do and how many people you're fighting and what the available targets are. So, for example, a cut to the head or the arm or the leg can easily finish a fight. Generally speaking, a cut to the body is unlikely to finish a fight. And in the medieval sources, we don't see any cuts to the body. We see cuts to the head, arms, and legs, and we see thrusts to the body. Okay. Thrusting at the face is great. It works really, really well, but it's difficult to do because the face is a small, quite well armored, naturally armored by bone target that is easy to move, whereas the body is a bit slower. Yep. So here's another thought. A book written in the late 15th century by a guy called Filippo Vadi, called De Arte Gladiatoria Dimicande, which means the art of sword fighting in earnest. He says that if you're against multiple opponents, don't use a thrust. And the reason is, he doesn't say this, but we've worked it out. The reason is that if your sword goes into somebody, it's stuck there for a moment, right? Where his friends can hit you. But if you're cutting, the blow will naturally clear itself out and you can keep moving more easily. So
I'm not sure about that. I was just thinking about it when you were making the motion. It could just as easily get stuck if you're swiping somebody, and you, especially if you hit them in the body and not the neck or something, it could easily get stuck in them, and then you got to fight with the sword to get it out of their body. No,
we've done quite a lot of cutting practice on various things, including carcasses of animals hung up and. I've not found that to be the case. I don't recall my sword ever getting stuck like that.
Wow.
Because you don't strike and stop. You swing through and you keep moving, and right. The sword naturally clears itself.
Interesting.
That's been my experience. I mean, you know, other people's mileage may vary, but
what about the physical attributes necessary to do this? I mean, obviously, the physical attributes you have, your strength, your agility, and all that stuff is going to have some effect on the sword that you choose that's the right sword for you, but also the other way around, your natural abilities can hamper or make you better with a certain sword, right? So what about that? You kind of match a sword for the person?
Okay. Within a certain style, generally speaking, shorter people use shorter swords. So the sword should be in proportion to the person.
Nice.
Okay. And some styles give certain body types an advantage. So, for example, if you're doing a style which has lots and lots of thrusts from far away, like the rapier, then being tall and lanky is a good idea. Right, it really helps because you can simply strike from further away.
Right.
Okay, there's a definite advantage to being tall, but if you're doing, for example, medieval longsword, then yes, there is an advantage at the outside of measure, so the very early stages of the fight. But when it gets into close quarters, you want to be a good wrestler, and wrestlers tend to be short and heavy. A good wrestler has a low center of gravity and short levers to be used against him.
Right.
So, like, one of the most famous knights, and of course, because it's live, I'm blanking on the name. The the knight who led the English knights at Agincourt. He was famously short, right? And he was reckoned to be the best knight in England.
Right. Interesting. Right? That's an interesting point. I think a lot of us never even consider that, but we have natural physical attributes that make a certain style of fighting more friendly for our body type. And I, you know, I've always thought of myself as a better wrestler than boxer because I do have a lower center of gravity, but it wasn't something that I kind of could articulate until just this moment. I mean, but hearing you say that, it makes a lot of sense to me. So it's just something that I never really considered before. Now, what about this? It's a martial art. If I want to go study Asian martial arts, I have to buy a gi and pay for the lessons. This seems like a much more expensive undertaking. Yeah.
Yes and no. It kind of depends. Most clubs, if they can, have gear that they can lend to beginners. But if you're going to be doing it long term, you will end up spending quite a lot of money on it, right? A decent sword starts around $300 and goes up from there, right? And people tend not to buy just one sword.
Yeah, right.
They tend to kind of get bitten by the bug. But like, for example, again, my school in Helsinki, we have enough loaner equipment that we can equip a beginner's course of, say, 20 people with a steel practice longsword and a mask. And we can just lend them the equipment until they're ready to buy it. But, you know, pretty much everything costs money, and the better quality, the better. And, right. I know people who've spent maybe $3,000 on tattoos who think $300 for a sword is a lot of money.
Yeah, no.
Now, I don't have any tattoos, but I have a lot of swords.
Right.
You just choose where you put your money, really.
I get it. I see guitar porn all the time, and that's the question. Is there sword porn? Like, there are websites where you're just scrolling through pictures of expensive swords and stuff like that and drooling over them?
is there ever? Yes, absolutely. There are loads of. In fact, one of my favorite makers of swords, person who made about four of these, is armsandarmor.com. His name is Craig Johnson in the States. And he has a regular thing where he posts on social media like sword porn of the day. And it'll either be something he's made and they're gorgeous, or it'll be something from one of the historical collections and they are gorgeous. And yeah, it's like everything, you know. I'm also a woodworker as well as a sword person, and I sometimes spend time like browsing through catalogs of amazingly beautiful hand planes and go, oh my god, that's beautiful, and I don't usually buy it, or if I do, don't tell my wife because I might get in trouble. Right. But yeah, I mean, it's like with any activity which has sort of objects attached. But even like online gamers, they have like special keyboards and special mice and special headphones and all that sort of stuff, and they geek out over the gear. It's just something that people do.
Yeah, I know. I'm sure Craig Johnson is a fairly common name anywhere in the world, but Craig Johnson is a huge supporter of this program. I'm going to have to have a little bit about this. Probably not the same one.
Okay. Well, this is a sword maker in Minnesota.
I'm going to have to ask him about this. Okay. Are you in any way related to the Craig Johnson, the sword guy? very, very interesting stuff. I know you mentioned you have a podcast and you've written several books. I'll just show one here. Tell me about the podcast, in particular. I mean, what is that interview style, and you're getting experts from all over the world? I mean,
most of it is, we're at about 70, 73 episodes, something like that. Most of it is an interview with somebody from the historical sword fighting world or something adjacent. So for example, Craig Johnson has been on the show talking about how you make swords. We've had professional historians on talking about how you figure out what these sources actually mean. We've had like tournament fencers on, people who have done really well in sort of historical martial arts inspired tournaments, like with long swords, for example, people who run clubs, people who've written books. You know, it's and part of the goal of the show is to sort of display the massive diversity that already exists within historical martial arts. So we have people from, you know, Asia and South America, and even from America, like even from the United States. Really far afield. And yeah, and the point of it really is that what we are as a community is we are sword people, right? We are just like, some people go for guitars, other people just go for swords. And if you just go for swords, you should be able to find somebody like you on the show.
Wow.
That's kind of the point of it.
Interesting. So there's no shortage of sword people for you to have guests. You know what? You learned. I'm sure most of my audience is probably not aware of this. And that it's something that once you find out there's people that are interested in it, of course, now you're going to see millions of them everywhere. It's like when you, I forget what the psychological term of that is, but when you're looking for new cars and you look at one you like, all of a sudden you see that car everywhere. Now I'm sure sword people are going to show up in my life everywhere. because you become aware of it.
And the thing is, you know, most little kids are sword people, right? You know, you give a little kid a sword and they start beating the crap out of you, and it's adorable and great. And you know, some of us just never grew out of that.
Right. Yeah. And, you know, that's right. So I'm thinking it's probably part of, because kids aren't taught that. I mean, you give a little kid who's never seen anything about sword stuff, anything that's remotely shaped like a sword, you could give them a wiffle ball bat and they'll start doing sword fighting moves with it.
They absolutely will. And then you show them something like Star Wars or Zorro or Three Musketeers or Game of Thrones, not Game of Thrones, it's not for little kids, but you get the idea. And they go, oh, that's so cool.
Right.
And they kind of imprint on it. And then, you know, I don't tell anyone, but actually I'm a Jedi. I just don't do the mind stuff.
Yeah. Before I ask you about the books on the podcast, when how often does the podcast come out? And when do you publish it?
It comes out every Friday morning. So 8 a.m. UK time. So middle of the night for Americans.
And people can find out about it at guywindsor.net?
Yep. If they just put podcast, there's a thing that you can click podcast.
Right.
And or guywindsor.net/podcast will also find it, or just, you know, in put the sword guy into your podcast app and that it'll pop right up.
Gotcha. Now on to the books. You've written many books, and that's kind of curious, because it seems like how many books do we need? I mean, no disrespect, but it seems like one book should cover it, maybe two.
No.
why? What am I missing?
Okay. All right. Well, firstly, the process of figuring out how sword fighting works from historical sources is complicated and involved. And there are lots of different stages of it. And the way I learn something is I decide to write a book about it. And so that gives a kind of focus and structure to my research. Okay. So I'm partly writing just for my own sort of curiosity. I want to know what this book will look like. But also, now that I've been doing it for a long time, my first book came out in 2004. There are people who have found my books really, really useful, and they come and tell me that. And I'm like, and then they say, well, Guy, actually, and then they ask me these questions. And the questions go, do you know what? These questions, the answers to these questions, well, I could write you an email, but I might as well just write a book. Because then you get a really thorough and complete answer. So, you know, well, for example, one book of mine that came out last year, it's called From Medieval Manuscript to Modern Practice. And what that is what I think of the bits in this manuscript, Fiore's Il Fiore di Battaglia, the Flower of Battle, but just the longsword out of armor on foot. Right, so just that section of it, I've taken every single play, transcribed the written Italian, so you can actually kind of read it, and then translated it, and then described how I think the action should go, and then there's a clip to a video of me actually doing it. So what that means is that anyone who is interested in what I think or how I think this particular technique should work and how those techniques all fit together into a coherent system has the book. Right. And I could write like three more of these on other sections of the manuscript easily. Well, not easily. It takes a lot of work, but there's a lot of material there.
Right.
Just in this one manuscript. And there are lots of other manuscripts. Another thing that people need is translations. So I've got one published translation of a medieval manuscript, late 15th century manuscript. The one that got stolen by Cesare Borgia, right? That's the one that I translated, because a lot of people don't read Italian. And if they do read Italian, they might not be that comfortable with Italian from the 15th century, although actually they're pretty similar, right? If you read it aloud, a modern Italian person can usually understand it. It's just sometimes quite difficult to read. Okay. Wow. And then you've got other books, like how do you take all of these different techniques and actually train them? Well, I've got another book for that. I've got lots and lots and lots and lots of books. So this one, right? That is all of these techniques, or not all of these techniques, most of these techniques organized into a training method so you can actually, it says a training manual.
Right.
Right?
So that would be, sorry to interrupt, but that would be more for a trainer rather than the actual person who's looking to learn about it, or am I wrong?
No. Well, okay. Most of the people that get this book either don't have a teacher or are training in a club, and the teacher has said, well, okay, we're doing this Fiore stuff. Guy's written a bunch of books. You should go read his books because I don't agree with everything, but generally they're okay. Right? Or something like that. Yeah. So if you like, you've got the manuscript itself, then you've got how you think those techniques should be done, and then you've got how they should be organized into something you can actually train. And depending on the student's interests, you're going to one or the other. And of course, there are dozens and dozens of these manuscripts and historical sources. So I've written other books on other historical sources and other books on how to train. So for example, this one, which is the latest one, came out this year. It's called The Windsor Method, because I'm
right,
not
that's
shy.
That's the one I was showing, right? No? No.
No, no, you were showing Swordfighting, which is an older one.
Oh, that's the one that's in the thumbnail for today's program. That's
right, yeah. Yeah, yeah. And this is called Principles of Solo Training, because during the pandemic, lots of people were stuck at home and they couldn't get to their sword club and they couldn't get their necessary sword fix. Right? It's a healthy addiction, swords. Right? And so I have an online course for how to train on your own with lots of exercises and what have you. And so people were using that. But I realized that the academic structure, no, the theoretical structure that you need in your head to understand how you should adapt things to yourself is very difficult to do on video because it's too big an idea. So basically, your body is different to everybody else's. And what works for you, and your mind is even more different to everybody else's. So how do you adapt your training, particularly when you're training on your own and you don't have to worry about the other people around you because there aren't any, right? How do you stay fit, stay strong, get stronger, get fitter, get more skilled at your art when you don't have training partners and when you need to, where you have the opportunity to adapt everything precisely to how you personally work. So basically, the message of the Windsor Method book is find out what works for you, and here's how you do that, and then do it, and here's how you do that.
Right. Well, I could probably keep you for another hour on this. I do have a couple more stupid questions, and then I'll let you go.
No stupid questions.
Well, I feel like, because I feel pretty uninformed about this stuff, so everything I feel I'm asking is pretty naive. Now, fencing. Is that related to what you teach at all? Because fencing is an Olympic sport, and why I'm asking this is because I want to know if there's any kind of that kind of recognition for the kind of sports that you do. But is fencing part of what you do?
No. What happened was in the late 18th or early 19th century, people stopped dueling with swords, pretty much, in Europe anyway. And they largely stopped dueling with swords, but they kept fencing as an activity. And it basically evolved into a gentlemanly pastime and a competitive sport. And it changed radically in the 1970s, where electrification occurred in the 50s and 60s. And then it got completely changed as a, everything they do changed completely by the middle of the 80s,
right? Okay?
Because of electrification. So that is a modern sport, which you can trace a line all the way back to historical fencing, but it's so attenuated and the changes are so extreme that there's no need to take up sport fencing to be good at historical fencing. But a background in sport fencing certainly doesn't hurt. And I have a background in sport fencing myself, because in the 80s, when I was a kid and into swords, my parents said, you should do fencing. So I did. And, you know, I didn't kind of discover the whole idea of doing the historical research and doing swordsmanship based on historical sources until the early 90s.
What about competitive sports for what you do, though? Is there a competitive sport?
There are tournaments that are held primarily, most commonly, for longsword and for rapier, but also for other weapons as well. Those are just the most common ones. And some people train to win the tournaments. And it's really interesting because we're seeing happening in real time over the last 15 years or so since people started organizing these tournaments, that what wins in a tournament with this equipment and these rule sets is different to what we see in these historical sources. Because, of course, you adapt what you do to make it work in the situation you find yourself.
Right.
And if the historical source says you need to break their arm and then smack them over the head 27 times, right? You can't do that in a tournament. So some tournaments don't allow any wrestling, for example. Other tournaments sort of privilege the wrestling. So some people who are good wrestlers will go into the kind of more wrestling oriented tournaments, and others will go into the more whack 'em with the sword oriented tournaments. And but we're seeing what people are actually doing in tournaments changing over time as the tournament environment changes.
Cool.
It's fascinating from a fencing historian's perspective.
Fascinating
living experiment.
So interesting. Is there a, and I'm going to guess there's not, but is there a world champion, like a world champion rapier world champion?
No, not really. I mean, there are tournaments that have gained a lot of prestige and tournaments that are, you know, sort of well respected, but there isn't a central governing body, thank God, because it would be like herding cats, right? There's no central governing body, and so there is no formal rule set that everyone plays by. Like with sport fencing, you've got the FIE, the Fédération Internationale d'Escrime, so it's French for International Fencing Federation, which creates the rule sets about blade length and how the electricity stuff works and the rules and all of that stuff, right? How it's scored, all of that is set by the FIE. And so there are world championships in sport fencing because it's a sport with a governing body that can actually hold a world championship.
Gotcha.
But we don't have, we will probably, the sporty side of what I do will probably organize itself into something like that sometime in the next 20 years, I would guess.
You would think so, because the world loves personality, right? And so in everything we see that people have an interest in, there are celebrated personalities. And I would think just because there are so many people who are interested in this, there would be a need for that Tiger Woods for golf, or, you know, Jimmy Page for guitar, or whatever.
And we do have people like that who are like world famous for, well, world famous in our community,
right,
for being really, really good at winning tournaments. But we also have people who are world famous in our community for doing really, really good translations of obscure Spanish sources. And people who are well known, well, like me, I write tons and tons of books, and I'm quite well known in my field. Pretty much everybody knows who I am, and an awful lot of them have bought my books, which is great. It pays the bills,
right,
but we are still sort of niche enough and diverse enough that we have these various different areas of what we do. And someone who's really, really good at hitting people with swords gets a lot of respect, but someone who's really, really good at working with historical sources also gets a lot of respect.
Right. I've kind of disrespected your time enough, I think. I do have one more question, which is it's pertinent to, it's important for anybody who's interested in getting into this. Now, the question is, like, if I go for a martial arts course here, before I even start to spar or learn how to really even throw a punch or a kick, they're going to have me doing certain exercises for physical fitness and to develop the muscle and muscle and techniques that will go into what I do. How much of that is part of what of swordsmanship? Is there any like physical regimen workouts before you actually touch a sword?
Well, okay. When students come to me for their very first sword class, they always get to use swords, or at least handle swords, in their first class because they're there for the swords. But when they realize that actually they're not going to get so far until they've sorted out their lack of hip flexibility or their lack of shoulder strength or whatever it is, then I can sort of sell them on the conditioning side of things. Right. And an awful lot of my solo training book is about physical conditioning. So what you eat, how you sleep, stretching, strength training, all that sort of stuff, because that's really, really important to get to a particular level. Right. Because unless you are sufficiently strong, sufficiently agile, sufficiently quick, you're going to be frustrated in your progress. Right. But any given student is being limited by a particular factor on any given day. So, for example, a student over here, they might really need to work on the precision with which they stick their point in the target.
Yeah.
The student over there might really need to work on their timing. They can get the point exactly where they want it to go, but they're always late.
Right.
Whereas student in the middle might need to work on lower back strength or flexibility in the lunge or whatever. And so we need to have all of this material, which is not historical martial arts, for the purposes of sort of supporting our historical martial arts practice. So yeah, we do a lot of push-ups.
Right. Is it very aerobic when you're done with a session, or I don't know if would you even call it sparring, whatever you call it, when you're doing it? Basically, when you're done, you're winded, and is it that kind of exercise?
It often is, and it certainly can be. The paradox of martial arts generally is the better you get, the less hard you have to work to do the same thing.
Right.
Okay. So ideally with a sword, I'm standing there with a sword and you're coming towards me and I do that, boink, and that's the fight. Right. So I've had the experience of a man in my late 40s fencing 7 or 8 students one after the other. They all get tired and I'm fine at the end of it, not because I'm that much fitter. I'm not fitter than them, they're fitter than me, but I'm working much less hard because I'm more efficient. Gotcha. Which means that I have to do lots and lots of other exercises like squats and push-ups and that sort of thing to keep my fitness levels up, because just the fencing isn't that good at it. Armored combat's different. We started out talking about how light armor is, or how not terribly heavy armor is. But if you wear armor for a few hours, you're getting a workout for sure.
Yeah, I can imagine that. Yeah, when I saw that glove, I thought, wow, that's got to be, after a half hour, I would be ready for bed. one more question, because it's so fascinating, man. In the guitar world now, and this is only, I've been playing guitar for 55 years, and it only recently have I noticed how much difference hands make in the handling of the equipment and neck radius. And there are different radiuses for guitar. Now, I have very short fingers, fat, stubby fingers, and a typical really good guitar player will have long and nimble fingers. Yeah. But that my hands make a difference radius wise and with the kind of guitars I can play. And I've noticed, because my partner has been buying guitars like crazy, and I've noticed the difference in those neck sizes and how I have to adjust my playing for different neck sizes, handles and stuff for swords. Does that physical attribute of your hands come into play there, and fitting the right sword to the right hand type?
Yeah, well, one thing I do with my students when they buy a new sword is, because I'm also a woodworker and I can have some sort of craft skills, is I tailor the handle to their hand. Because there is, for any particular kind of sword, there is an optimal size so that, I'll just move my hand closer so you can see what's going on. So that right now, my hand is completely around the grip and I can hold it comfortably with just the one finger. But most importantly, these three fingers are all touching here. So right. I have plenty of maneuverability and I have that, it's called a closed kinematic chain, where the thumb is connected to these fingers. Less so the little finger. The little finger is less important. But it's in European, in Japanese swordsmanship, it's all about the little finger. But in European swordsmanship, the little finger is less important. But you often find a sword has a really chunky handle, and it's exhausting to hold it because you can't get your body behind it properly.
Right.
So yeah, I mean, I tailor all of my swords to my hands. And when I get a sword custom made, as I usually do these days, again, I have the handle literally tailored to my hands.
Wow.
Because then it fits just perfectly and it works beautifully. And
very cool stuff, man. I got to tell you, now my interest level is grown just because of
excellent. Take up the art. You're never too old. It's never too late.
Well, that would be learn my final something. Question is like, people I'm in my 60s. I mean, really, seriously, I mean, people in their 60s and 70s can do this.
I had a student who is a woman in her mid-60s in sort of New England start training this year.
Wow.
Right? I had a student who started training with me in Helsinki when he was nearly 70.
Wow.
Right? The thing is, you're going to get older no matter what you do. Right? In 5 years' time, you'll be 5 years older or dead. Those are the options, right? You might as well spend that time full of swords, right? And yeah, it's true that you'll probably never get to the same pinnacle of like martial excellence that you could have got to if you started when you were 10.
Right.
But so what? Right. It's not a skill that your life depends on anymore. And it's not a skill that your income depends on unless you're me. So, if you're attracted to them, if you think swords are cool, then no matter how old you are or what condition you're in, you might as well pick one up and have a go.
Yeah, I'm more at this point, and I agree with you. I'm not disagreeing, but at this point in my life, I'm actually more interested in the spectator part of it and seeing people who are really, really good at it and admiring their skill level and admiring what how they learn to do these things. That's what really interests me. But I would definitely pick one up and give it a try and see how it feels.
We should.
Yeah, definitely. If when all this stuff is over and you come back to the States, please make sure that I know about it somehow. I mean, be in touch.
I certainly will. Yeah. Of course.
I appreciate your time and your patience with my naivety.
Good questions.
Yeah.
Good questions. Lovely talking to you.
And I wish you great success and keep in touch. If you ever want to come back, I'm probably could ask you more questions for another hour and a half, I think.
Brilliant. Love to.
Anyway, thank you for coming. Bye for now. Be well.
Bye. Thanks, Matt.
Dr. Guy Windsor, folks. Swordsmanship, good stuff. If you're interested, obviously there are clubs here in the States and there are clubs all over the world. Might be a good idea to put together a resource of where you can find all these clubs in your local worldwide map of swords clubs that we can offer our listeners who might be interested in this. I hope you found something really interesting in this program and got something out of it. Love to hear your questions and comments. info@minddogtv.com, info@minddogtv.com. Tonight at 8 p.m. Bob Yarry, an award-winning, Academy Award-winning producer of films such as Crash and many, many films. I think he has 3 Academy Award-winning films that he's produced, but he's produced many, many films. I think upwards of 80 films. Currently produces the series Yellowstone featuring Kevin Costner, starring Kevin Costner. Should be a very interesting conversation with Bob Yarry tonight on filmmaking and also the book that he just wrote and published. So I hope you'll join me then. Till then, I'm Matt Knappel for the Mind Dog TV podcast. Thanks for joining me. Have a great rest of your day and bye for now.